Hey everyone, today's episode is brought to you by Waterloo. We know you're traveling to Britain because it's beautiful. And while you're over there, you're probably going to see the rest of the United Kingdom, those Scottish foothills, the Welsh lands, and Northern Ireland. It's my favorite section of Ireland. While you're over there, though, you got to take care of business. And I'm not talking about working abroad. I'm talking about number two. You know, you got to go to the bathroom. That's why we invented Waterloo. This internationally charged app finds you the location of all public restrooms. Let me tell you, Americans out there, public restrooms are tough to find in England. With Waterloo, it's not tough to find. With Waterloo, you just open up the app and using satellite GPS positioning, you find that closest restroom. And with Waterloo Premium, our whizzing engineers, Todd and Jason, have found the best public park spots where you can urinate outdoors if needed. As if you subscribe to the premium for $4.99 a month. Try the promo code YOURLIFE, and you get a week free of premium. So that's not a bad deal. That's Waterloo from the makers of Hulu. And remember, everyone, when your bowels need a Brexit, use Waterloo. Waterloo is another Donafort industry innovation. Welcome to the Critical Breakdown, the podcast where we start at the bottom of Rotten Tomatoes and work our way to 100% fresh. I'm Scott.
And I'm Max, and today we're talking about both Varsity Blues and Hot Rod for our first Versus episode.
Versus episode.
Cue the lightning.
Cue the metal music.
And cue the episode.
Ooh.
Yeah. So we're doing two today.
We're doing a twofer.
Twofer.
The percentage so nice, we reviewed it twice. What have you been watching lately, though?
Well, I've had a TV week.
TV week?
Done a lot of TV.
Like a TV week.
A lot of television.
What specifically?
Well, a lot of weird good stuff. But, you know, we're still working on Party of Five. I'll have an update about that in a second.
Great, great. Always look forward to that.
A couple months ago, I guess last year, I started watching Halt and Catch Fire, which is another AMC series that has some good critical reviews to it. Stars Lee Pace, Mackenzie Davis, and Scoot McNeary.
I know a lot of those names.
Yeah. It's set in the 80s, like early set of the 80s. It's during the personal computer revolution.
Yeah.
And it's just kind of an up-and-coming company competing with IBM. And there's a lot of drama involved in it, and it's pretty good.
Yeah, cool.
It's definitely, if you enjoy the 80s period piece movement that's kind of been happening in television,
With Stranger Things and stuff.
Stranger Things, the other show that I've been watching, which is The Americans.
Oh, great show.
And I know you're ahead of me on that one. Yeah. I've had a couple people, I know this happened to you at one point, but you jump back in. It happened to my other friend that watched The Americans. When you start watching it, it's like the beginning of every season is super addictive, and the ending is super amazing. But there's like a small slump in the center of
some of them, yeah.
And I think it's just because they have so much tiny threads moving that it's easy to get lost in the details.
It's like they set everything up with those first couple episodes, and then it like trickles down a little bit for the middle five.
Yeah.
And then when it all comes together again, it's really cool.
Yeah. And so far, I mean, every season I've watched fully, it pays off. But no, I'm enjoying it. It's good.
I think it's a very underrated show. I don't think a lot of people watch it. Most people I know don't watch it, but I think
they should. Yeah, I constantly tell people to watch it. Yeah. It's kind of like where I'm at with that.
Yeah.
But it's, you know, for people that don't know, The Americans is a show about a deep espionage program from the Soviet Union inside the America. Yeah. The United States during the
DC.
Cold War.
Yeah.
And they just have infiltrators who are completely just normalized into American society, but they're sleeper agents. They know they're agents. I mean, they're not like
they're
sleeper
acting
agents.
On behalf of the USSR.
Yeah. And they actively have different personalities they become. So it's more than just like being a spy and going out and doing something. You have this whole persona that you have to be different people at once. And I just got to a point in season three where Philip kind of talks about the training he went into.
Mm-hmm.
It's very disturbing stuff.
Yeah.
And in the first season, they touch on, I think her name's Elizabeth.
Yep.
Yep. On her training, and it was very disturbing as well.
Yeah. The whole thing is.
It's a good way of, it's a show that has protagonists who are acting against, you know, our government.
Yeah.
And you root for the protagonist, but then at the same time, you know they're doing something that you wouldn't actually agree with.
Yeah.
But then you see all the time that their organization is terrible as well. So it's just like a whole show of grays.
Yeah, it really is. Just
moral gray zone.
I think the coolest part is, like, you kind of mentioned the period piece stuff. And they wear, like, wigs and costumes and stuff all the time. And it looks both really goofy and really, like, real. And it's pretty cool. Like, they all have, like, shitty wig hair. But it's awesome.
What works is that everyone else just looks early 80s shitty.
Yeah, so it's like Mad Matches.
Yeah. And both of these shows do this well. It's what Stranger Things did well as well. They use, you know, the 80s furniture, the 80s design, the 80s clothes. But it's not forced. It's not gaudy. Yeah. It's not like...
Like, hey, look, we're the 80s.
Yeah, it's not like that 70s show looks very fake on purpose. Yeah, it's not like that. It's a very, like, organic feel to it.
Yeah, like, that 70s show is almost a parody of the 70s.
Yeah.
The Americans, that's just the setting. Yeah, Stranger Things is just the setting, so.
And then the last show I've been watching, you actually caught a piece of,
which
was Legion.
Yeah.
The new FX show.
That's hot show.
It's connected to the X-Men universe.
Yep.
And, I'll let people kind of watch that one a little bit more before we talk about
Pretty
it.
Pretty fresh. But including me, I want to watch it.
I'll say that I enjoyed it. It's
great. I enjoyed the 30 minutes of the episode that I saw. It's directed and created by Noah Hawley, who did the Fargo, who actively does the Fargo series of anthology series. So, and he's got a really distinctive style, and he just does really good stuff so far with that. I'm really high on him right now because I just finished Fargo.
Yeah. And this stars Dan Stevens.
Yep.
Who you might know from Downton Abbey. He's in the upcoming Beauty and the Beast. Has Aubrey Plaza and a couple other recognizable people.
Yeah.
You might not know him, but you recognize them.
So. Yeah, the guy, I haven't even seen the full first episode, but the guy who's interrogating Legion with, like, the slick back hair, he played a really scummy character on the Newsroom show. Mm-hmm. I believe his character's name was Jerry Fontana.
That's a scummy name.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he, like, forged a bunch of evidence and stuff, or, like, made fictional accounts of things, and they got, like, sued from it. But that show's not worth diving into. That's one of those guys who's just like, oh, yeah, that guy.
Yeah.
But you could never, like, place him on purpose, I don't think.
Yeah.
But now it looks good. I think we'll talk about it more down the road.
Yeah, for sure.
They're only like 2 or 3 episodes in now. Yeah. So
by the time we get caught up, we'll have a little powwow here on that.
Yeah, a little powwow.
And just for your, like I said, your weekly Party of Five update.
Yes, please.
Jules found out she was pregnant and planned on getting an abortion, but then she miscarried.
Oh, well, that's convenient.
It is, but it still kind of devastated her emotionally.
Sure.
Charlie has, he called off his wedding. And then he got into a relationship too fast right after and had to back out of that too.
I think we've all been there.
Yeah. Bailey and Sarah are still just, they're trying, man. They're trying, but things aren't always going their way.
Yeah, okay.
And then you got Claudia, and she no longer plays violin.
Oh, no.
But no, she's happy with it. She felt forced into it.
By?
Just by her family. Her mom is a famous musician, so.
That'll do it.
Yeah. And that's my week.
Thanks for that update on Party of Five.
What are you gonna watch?
Can't wait till next week.
Dude, it gets crazier.
I bet. I've had like I was in a really good movie crunch where I was watching a bunch of movies, and then I kind of hit the brakes on that. Not before watching Wolf of Wall Street, though. It's one of the ones I hadn't seen that I wanted to, and I actually really enjoyed it. I didn't think I was going to that much because the whole thing about it is like greed, and it's very gaudy on purpose, and it's very long. It's like 3 hours. I generally don't enjoy those themes.
Yeah.
But a couple weeks back, I watched Wall Street, Money Never Sleeps, and I thought that one was pretty good, so I jumped in on Wolf of Wall Street, because they're definitely borrowing on the same themes. But it's really good. Leo's really good in it. There's a really good ensemble. Jonah Hill is amazing in it. John Bernthal's in it. I mean, I could go on and on, honestly, but... It's got your girl.
Your girl.
Harley Quinn.
HQ.
Rob Reiner's in it.
Classic.
Yeah. No, I mean, I think a lot of people have seen Wolf of Wall Street. Yeah, McConaughey has a very brief role in it.
He looks creepy in it.
My boy Kyle Chandler.
Your boy.
He's in it. So, no, I mean, the huge ensemble. Martin Scorsese, obviously. And it really does go over the top with all of its, the actions of the protagonist. And
I did read at one point that they actually left stuff out. from his book. Like
the, yeah, because like people wouldn't believe it. Yeah, yeah, that's what
and
I read too.
I'm just like, wow, that's cool and weird.
One of my favorite little facts is so the character that Leo portrays, and he's a real human being, is Jordan Belfort. And all of this is based on true stories. And at the very end of the movie, Jordan Belfort's like about to give a sales presentation, which is ironic. And there's like people like watching. He's like doing like a seminar series. And all these people are eating it up, which is ironic because he got his big hook because he was a sales guy who did scummy illegal tactics. And now all these people are still wanting to see him sell his own salesmanship. But the funny thing is, presenting Leo DiCaprio's Jordan Belfort is the actual Jordan Belfort. And it's just really funny cameo once you realize it. But no, it was really cool. I enjoyed it. I like the first half better than the second half. I watched it in like three sittings.
Yeah, makes sense.
But no, I really enjoyed it. And then, you know, it'd been a while. So I'm watching The Office again.
It's the go-to for a lot of people.
I just jumped in on season 8. I don't know why.
See, what I like about longer shows is you could just jump it in.
Yeah, yeah. So. And so... So someone, there's 4 users on my Netflix account, unless it's illegal, in which case there's not.
There's no users.
There's no users. So someone had watched up to season 7, and so the next one that just autoplayed was the first episode of season 8, so I was like, yeah, I'll get on that. So it's funny.
I admit that I like the first half of The Office better.
I think everybody does.
But
I think the second half is underrated, though. A lot of people are like, oh, it sucks.
It becomes a different show.
Yeah.
It becomes a different show, for sure. And there's good stuff there.
Yeah. I mean, the writing is still really good. Yeah. I'm trying to remember the episode I just watched. I just watched one where Michael read about China at the dentist's office. And then he got really smart, and he was debating Oscar about something. And this diatribe isn't even going to connect, I already know, so I'm not going to finish it, but it's a very funny episode.
That's an older one, though, right?
That's, like, the 3rd or 4th episode of season 8.
Hmm. Michael's in that one?
Yeah.
My whole...
I think there's 11 seasons.
Oh, okay.
Maybe 10.
When does he leave?
Season 8. Like, I think 5 or 7 episodes in he does, because I just watched the episode where Holly comes back.
Yeah. Oh, okay. So. See, in my head, like, shortly after Jim and Pam got married, all of that. I know there's, like, a lot more, but in my head, it's, like, 2 seasons afterwards. Because I never fully watched them until recently. So, like, I just sporadically would catch the episodes after that.
Yeah.
So then it's, like...
Like, clumps together.
Yeah. So, like, that's compressed almost. It's, like, a digest version of it. So I was like, what season did that happen in?
Yeah. But, yeah, right after Michael left, it was weird. Like, they had Will Ferrell on for, like, 4 episodes. Yeah. And they had a few different things going on. But it wasn't that great again until, like, the last season I remember really enjoying. So I'm excited to get to that again. But, yeah, you know, just kind of chilling.
Chilling?
Yeah. New Power Rangers trailer.
Yeah, there is.
That movie looks like stinky hot garbage.
It's...
I have a lot of love for the source material, though.
I love the first, like, iteration of Power Rangers. I never really stuck with it beyond that. Yeah. But I did, you know, you kind of hope when you hear these things are getting a new version that it looks awesome. We do know a Power Rangers fan who's pretty stoked about it, but...
Miles, yeah. He's a big Power Rangers fan. Yeah.
And he seems pretty on it.
Former podcast guest, Miles.
Yeah.
And host... Of The More You Nerd.
The More You Nerd. And I'm not like deep in the fandom, so I'm not gonna be either way. But if it gets a good buzz, I'll probably see it. If you want to see it, I'll probably see it.
I think I'll see it because I watched maybe like 5 or 6 seasons as a kid. I remember I would record the episodes on VHS.
Yeah.
And then I realized when I was like 9 that I would always record. I had like 3 VHSs, and we would just like pop them in to record over the old ones. Nice. And I remember for Christmas one year, I got the whole, like, Green Ranger arc on VHS. It was, like, 8 tapes.
Hell yeah, dude.
It was awesome.
I think I got 3 seasons in, and then I was like, this stuff's for kids. I'm going to watch something real and adult. So I started watching Ronin Warriors, which is just, like, an anime version of Power Rangers.
Yeah, you showed me the trailer of it just now, and it's like, yep.
I just wanted a more mature Power Rangers.
Yeah, no, hey, I get that. Yeah. It's like when I wanted to watch a more mature Finding Nemo, I watched The Perfect Storm.
Exactly like that.
Now, did you ever watch that short film Power Rangers one that was like really dark and...
Oh, yeah.
Like, it came out like 5 years ago or something.
It was called like Power Ranger or something. You know, James Vanderbeek was in that.
No way. James Vanderbeek?
James Vanderbeek. The star...
Of Dawson's Creek.
and Varsity Blues.
Whoa. That's a bringer back. That's the first bringer back of the episode.
Hashtag bringer back.
Yes.
Yeah, guys, if you talk about this episode at all, just make sure you hashtag your tweets with bringer back.
Hashtag bringer back is this week's hashtag. Yeah, so we watched Varsity Blues and we watched Hot Rod.
Yeah.
Why did we do a twofer?
Well, gosh, first of all, how do you pick?
Yeah.
We had a couple other options out there.
Yeah, what were the other options?
We had He's Just Not That Into You.
Was that one of those like big ensemble movies?
It's an ensemble
Ben movie. Affleck. Affleck. I want to say there was a McConaughey snuck in there.
I feel like Cameron Diaz or Scarlett Johansson might be in it.
I want to see your girl Jessica Biel's in it.
Oh, for sure.
Aniston's in it.
That's how I know it's bad. When my girl Jessica Biel shows up, it's a bad movie.
That's why we passed.
Yeah. I'm just not into those ensemble films. Yeah, I'm just not into them.
So. Yeah, I'm not really into them either. The only one I actually like is Love Actually because it's a legitimately good movie. Apparently they greenlit a sequel. I don't know how I feel about that.
I can't wait to not watch it. then we skipped out on Reign of Fire.
I wanted to watch Reign of Fire.
It's
not over these ones, but like it's a weird cult classic almost.
It's not my favorite. It's a great idea. It's fun.
From what I've read, it was like ahead of its time.
Yeah, it just there's some things that didn't work in it.
Yeah.
Like the pacing of it, I didn't feel great about, but I like the concepts. Yeah. And there's some cool like set pieces that I don't even know if they hold up anymore, but they were cool at the time.
Because what it was like 2004 or something.
Yeah, and it's like dragons versus men on helicopters.
Yeah.
It's cool.
You had me right there.
Yeah. So there's stuff to it. It's just not great. Roadhouse, the Swayze film.
Yeah, I was told we made a big mistake not watching Roadhouse.
Who told you that?
I believe my mother.
Well, Mama Tenet, we respect your opinion.
Yeah, sure do.
Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, the 1990 film.
Oh, the 1990 film.
So, we didn't want to just like rehash something.
It's no TMNT 2, that's for sure.
It's true. And The Island.
Yeah, Michael Bay.
I actually, I enjoyed The Island when I saw it, but I knew it was complete garbage.
I remember liking the concept when I saw, like, the trailer in front of Transformers or something. Yeah. No, it would have come out before. Regardless, whatever. Revenge of the Sith.
Yeah, this was, like, 2004 or something.
But it's your boy, Ewan McGregor.
And ScarJo.
ScarJo.
That's a combo.
That gets you there.
I just, you know, they're hot.
They're not as hot as James Vanderbeek.
I don't think you can.
Or Andy Samberg.
so we did Hot Rod and Varsity Blues because Hot Rod is kind of one of those movies you have to talk about. It's this goofy comedy that came out of The Lonely Island who got their start on YouTube.
Yeah. And, well, they got their start on SNL.
Well, they had all their presence was on YouTube before that, actually.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so SNL saw them from YouTube and brought them in. So, I mean, their big SNL hit was Lazy Sunday.
Their first one, yeah.
Yeah. And that kind of, like, propelled them into actual modern pop culture pantheon of everything. So, it's like a... If you were doing a comedy timeline, it would definitely be a blip on the timeline.
Sure.
So, and then Varsity Blues is this ridiculous MTV football film that, I mean, everybody always quotes the famous line from it.
Yeah, I don't want your life.
I don't want your life.
The movie is like, I think it's the epitome of so bad it's good.
Oh, totally.
Like, a lot of the movies we watch are just bad. Like, The Da Vinci Code's just bad.
Yeah.
And Charlie St. Cloud is just good. Varsity Blues is so bad that it's good.
Yeah. So just some quick synopses for these.
Yeah, read them both at the same time.
I don't think I could do that. Okay, so Varsity Blues, after the star quarterback is injured, a backup quarterback is chosen to lead a Texas football team to victory.
Boom. That does sound a lot like Friday Night Lights, the TV show, though.
Yeah, it sounds like...
Star quarterback Jason Street gets injured, and your boy, the backup, Matt Saracen, gets in there.
It almost sounds like any football movie I've ever seen, but no, you're right.
No, it didn't happen in Remember the Titans.
Is that the one where they all died?
What the fuck? No.
Oh, no, that's the racism one.
Yeah, Remember the Titans is the one that everyone watched in high school every year they were in high school. Then you have We Are Marshall.
We Are Marshall, thank you.
Which is based on true story where the Marshall football team's plane crashed.
Notice I didn't say it was funny. I just said everyone died.
Isn't that the one where everyone died?
Is that not a proper description?
Of We Are Marshall, it is.
Yeah. Okay, so Hot Rod. Self-proclaimed stuntman Rod Kimball must jump 15 buses to raise the money to get his hard-ass stepfather a new heart so Rod can then defeat him in a fight.
Boom. A classic story. Another classic one.
So the funny thing here is they're both kind of like sports-themed, like loosely. Yeah. Stuntman isn't like a straight translation, but it's a person using their body to like force, this event. It's like an event thing.
They're both event movies.
Yeah. But, pushing human endurance. Yeah, so. Don't laugh at me, Scott.
I'm not laughing.
I'm making a connection here. They both overcome. They both have to like achieve.
There you go.
They're both about victory.
They're both, they both resent their father figure.
Yeah, there's father figure resentment. Yeah. There's no one taking you serious.
That's right.
They're both underdogs.
Sure are.
So, they both don't want your life.
Neither of them want their life for sure. Well, Rod Kimball kind of wanted his dad's life.
Yeah, but that's not actually his dad's life. Spoilers. So he did want his life, I guess.
All right, so let's get these box office numbers out there.
Yeah, let's do it.
This wasn't much of a versus. Hot Rod got beaten down on at the box. Hot Rod was good for $13.9 million its opening weekend. No, excuse me. I'm sorry. It was good for $5.3 million its opening weekend. And a total run of $13.9 million, which did not make up for its budget of $25 million. Varsity Blues, on the other hand, opened at $15.2 million. And then made a total of $53 million domestically.
That's how you do it.
And on a smaller budget, $16 million. So.
Hot Rod, I saw it twice opening weekend.
Yeah, so and that's reflected in the numbers.
Yeah, I threw my money in the pot.
There you go. I never saw Hot Rod. I know a lot of people who liked Hot Rod, though.
Yeah, I was big on Lonely Island at the time, as I think most young folk who were into the internet at the time
most
were.
Young folk.
But no, so I was like all in. I was all in.
Yeah.
They used to do this skit called the Bing Bong Brothers that I thought was really funny. And it was just like the Yin Yang Twins or something.
Okay. Yeah.
It's probably not funny now when I watch it, but I thought it was great back then.
After we watched Hot Rod, I watched a bunch of their music videos, like I'm on a Boat.
Oh, yeah.
And Jack Sparrow with Michael Bolton. That's a classic.
That's one of their. That's probably my favorite overall.
That's your favorite? I really like that one.
I love that one. I do like Jizz in My Pants.
Yeah.
And they're like when they're announcing that they're back, it's kind of like their trash talk song.
Okay.
I don't know if you've ever seen it.
I don't think
later.
I know that one.
There's just a line where one of them says, "I think I suffer from stinky dick. Every time I take a piss, it smells just like shit." And every time I hear it, they're just insulting themselves the whole time. It's so funny.
That is pretty funny. I'm trying to remember. I really like Mother Lover.
Yeah, that one's good.
That one's good. And
Dick in a Box.
Yeah, Dick in a Box is classic.
All their SNL stuff is always
what good. Was the one they did one about the president of Iran?
Oh, God.
Iran So Far Away with Adam Levine.
That one's beautiful.
That one's insane.
Honestly,
yeah.
It's just a pretty song.
Yeah, they do a lot of good stuff. And that's the thing. Like, it is weirdly good music.
Yeah.
I really want to see Popstar. And it's been... It's not for rent on Amazon Video yet.
Yeah.
And the last three times I've gone to Redbox, it has been out on Blu-ray. And I'm so pretentious that I won't rent the DVD.
There you go. That's why those sales are low on all these things.
Sorry, guys. Well, no, it's probably a good thing that other people have
What's
it.
Interesting is the Popstar one, it got pretty good critic reviews.
Yeah, but it was also a box office bomb.
So it's... They might not be able to fill the seats out as themselves.
Yeah, I think part of it is it's such a niche thing. It's like very smart musical humor, and when like you think about that, there's not a huge wide market for that versus The Hangover, which probably got similar critical response.
I'm not sure how well Zoolander did, but I know Zoolander is a cult classic, and it very much teeters between pop culture and smart humor.
Yeah.
And I think they definitely can follow that path. I just think they haven't found what works mainstream fully yet.
Yeah.
I think Popstar could have worked probably better if, I don't know, the last year hadn't been so ridiculous, but...
Maybe, yeah.
There's too many
factors. I mean, it came out in, like, May or something, right? Yeah. So, I don't know. I also think, like, just musical comedy isn't going to have a huge market in general. Yeah. Like, there's people who just don't see musicals, and musical comedy is the same way.
Yeah, that's true.
Like, one of my favorite stand-up comedians is Bo Burnham, and he does musical comedy, and I really like it. But he's not a very widespread mainstream stand-up comedian, so...
Yeah,
I don't know, there's just not a full market for it. Varsity Blues, they've tried to adapt a number of times. There was a pilot filmed in 2002 by MTV for a TV show.
Yeah.
That I tried really hard to find, but it never actually aired. And the IMDb page for it is very incomplete. So I don't think it ever saw the light of day, but it must not have been very good. But last year, CMT, Country Music Television, mm-hmm. announced that they're doing Varsity Blues TV show. So.
Damn, dude.
Yeah.
They should.
Varsity Blues is great.
It's one of the funniest damn movies ever.
How do you make the show? Do you... Because the movie, and we'll probably get into this here very shortly, but the movie, like, it's very funny, but it's funny because it's kind of crappy.
Yeah.
It's not purposefully funny a lot. And the moments where it tries to be purposefully funny aren't the funniest parts of it. So yeah. I wouldn't say Varsity Blues is a comedy.
Nah.
But I think if you're going to adapt into a TV show, you have to make it a comedy. Because if you don't, then it's just a worse Friday Night Lights.
But you can't do it sitcom. It has to be like...
Yeah.
But the thing is, if you go the documentary style, you're just basically making a funny Friday Night Lights.
Yeah.
So it gets like...
Well, Friday Night Lights was not a documentary.
No, I know it was a documentary, but it was just more of a roaming camera kind of thing where it wasn't like... Like, the moments in the locker room have it almost a documentary feel to it.
Yeah. Even though like, you're not, watching it.
Yeah, yeah. It's like a... So I'm just saying, like, if you go more that direction, it's going to feel like that.
I think anyone who's making a high school football-based show...
It's going to feel like that.
Yeah, but you have to do something to differentiate yourself from Friday Night Lights. Friday Night Lights went the murder subplot route, which was terrible, but that's the direction it went. So you have to go with the comedy direction, I think, if you're making...
There was a murder subplot?
God, it's not even worth getting into, but yes... In season 3, Jesse Plemons' character murders someone who tried to rape one of their friends, Lila, I believe. All right. And then they cover it up, and his dad's a cop, and his dad's investigating the murder. And it was a terrible, terrible, terrible subplot. And then by season 4, they just forgot about it.
There you go.
Which was the right thing to do.
You could. It's funny in shows when, like, the fans, the writers, everyone's just like, mm-mm.
Yeah, like, no, please.
We're done with that.
Yeah. It's really funny. Like, his dad helps him cover it up in the end, and it's... Yeah.
That's how you do it, man. Yeah. Want to get rid of that plot line.
It's a good dad.
Cover it up. Yeah. So just some talk about who's in these films.
Yeah. So let's start with Varsity Blues.
Varsity Blues, like we said, stars James Vanderbeek, the lovely James Vanderbeek.
James, we'd love to have you on the pod.
That's 100% serious, James.
Yeah. We also have Ali Larder, her first film.
She's gotten close so many times. Really?
No. Varsity Blues was her first movie that she was in.
Oh, I thought you meant to being first in our countdown.
She is. This is also her first appearance in the countdown. So her first film in multiple ways.
Yeah.
We do have a return from Amy Smart.
We have a couple returns.
Yeah, from The Butterfly Effect.
Yeah. Scott Kahn.
Scott Kahn, returning from...
Gone in 60 Seconds.
Was he in something else, too?
I don't think we ever...
Yeah. John Voight.
Oh my God, John Voight?
Yes. Returning. He was in Getaway, of course.
Of course.
And he plays the evil coach in this.
There's no close-ups of his mouth eating food.
Yeah, which is unfortunate.
Yeah.
Because sometimes the movie felt like it could use one. we got Paul Walker.
Yeah, Paul Walker.
He plays star quarterback Lance. Was that his name?
Lance.
Harbor or something?
Yeah, something like that.
And then... I think that's the only returnees we have, but we also have, like, Ron Lester, isn't it? He plays, was it Bubba? I don't even remember.
Billy Bob.
Weirdly close.
Point of trivia here, in Not Another Teen Movie, he plays another... that actor plays the same character, but his name is, like, Ronnie Ray.
And he's parodying himself.
Parodying.
Parodying himself. Parodying himself. Yes.
Yeah.
No, I mean, that's a pretty big 90s cast.
Yeah, it's... You
know, it's a lot of top notch.
Yeah, I was trying to think if there's anyone else. And I think
there probably is, but yeah, that mostly covers it. The running back was a main character, but he... I didn't recognize the actor. Same.
And then we have Hot Rod.
Hot Rod.
Which stars...
More relevant actors in today's lexicon.
Andy Samberg.
Yep. I don't know the names of the other two guys.
I think Jorma...
Akiva?
Akiva directed, I want to say.
Yeah, but he wasn't in it.
Yeah.
And then the third guy. The shortest of them.
Which is Jorma.
Jorma.
Yeah, and he played his brother Kevin.
Yep.
And then you have...
Danny McBride.
Bill Hader.
Isla Fisher?
Yeah.
Is that how we're going to pronounce it?
It's either Isla or Isla. I think it's
Isla. Isla feels more correct. Isla sounds like I'm pronouncing it wrong, but I don't know.
And Will Arnett.
Yeah, Will Arnett.
Yeah.
Ian McShane, your boy.
Ian McShane.
Is this his second appearance in a movie?
What else was he in?
We might have just watched something that he was in, like, independent of the podcast.
He's in Game of Thrones.
Yeah, yeah. But I remember you mentioning then that you really like him, and I didn't know too much of him. But we watched something since then that he was in.
That's probably true.
Yeah.
I feel like he was either in a Western or a medieval thing that wasn't Game of Thrones, yeah. But I didn't even know.
Yeah. I don't know
he's
either.
He's awesome.
Yeah. Was he in King Arthur by chance?
I don't know.
Yeah, I don't want to remember King Arthur.
And then Sissy Spacek?
Yeah, that was the mother, right?
Yeah.
Yep. And then a lot of like SNL alums. Chris Parnell.
Chris Parnell.
Probably more than I'm even thinking about. Yeah.
There's randos all over.
Yeah, but another talented ensemble, comedic ensemble.
Sure. Very well cast because everyone has chemistry.
Yeah, everyone does have chemistry.
There's believable relationships between them. It's a ridiculous premise. I mean, you know going into this that it's stupid. From like the first 5 minutes, you know you're going to be watching one of the dumbest films you've ever seen.
Yeah, one of my favorite trivia facts about Hot Rod is in the first 5 minutes, they do a stunt where they're jumping over a truck, I believe, on a homemade ramp. And the stuntman who was driving it's not even a moped, really. It's a bike with an engine on it.
It's a moped bike.
Yeah. He actually broke his leg performing this first time. And it looks very violent in the movie, and it is because he broke his leg.
Yeah.
But it starts off with a crash like that, and it's a very funny...
I mean, you could see why the critics...
It wasn't funny for that stuntman, I'm sure, but...
You could see with how much this film relies on slapstick.
Yeah.
That why the critics wouldn't be into it. But then the rest of the humor is the weird kind of Lonely Island humor.
Yeah.
And it builds up. I mean, the third act is definitely probably overall has some of the funniest stuff in it that pays off with like payoffs.
Yeah.
But there's funny stuff throughout the whole film. It's just, it borderlines on dumb.
Yeah. And sometimes it goes over that border and sometimes it stays right where you want it to be, which is on the border of dumb.
Yeah. Yeah.
So how are we going to break these two down?
Well, I think we're going to discuss a couple points here.
Yeah.
And kind of weigh each film against it.
Yeah.
Against these criteria. So we'll talk about the writing and the direction as one category. Do you want to go over all of them real quick?
No, let's just get into it.
Okay.
Keep people listening. What if someone's like, oh, you know, I don't care about visuals, so I'll stop after acting. Uh-uh. Wait a second.
And then we have music and boxing.
Oh, shit. Okay. Writing/direction.
Mm-hmm.
So, I think easily Hot Rod's the better written movie.
For sure.
Varsity Blues is a terribly written movie.
Varsity Blues is the writing of someone who just, like, copied other people's work.
Yeah, who...
kind of pulled out their thesaurus and made it work, basically. Yeah. They turned in a term paper that four other people wrote.
I'm going to add air quotes around the word work that you just used.
Yeah.
Because it doesn't really work.
I mean, what I mean by that is they just take moments that other sports movies or sports stories have earned, and they just use it to make their own story.
Yeah, it's very cliche loaded.
Yeah.
The star quarterback gets injured and the backup comes in. That's a cliche.
Yeah.
The disappointed dad is a cliche. Like, it's all over the map.
Like, the adversity he's facing is the fact that he wants to read Kurt Vonnegut and his coach won't let him.
The coach being the bad guy.
Yeah.
One of my favorite moments of this movie is right at the start, they're at a pep rally, which is also at 9 a.m., which I've never been to Texas, but in my high school, all the pep rallies were in the afternoon to keep you, like, pepped for the game.
I've talked to a couple Texans, and they say that football is actually this way out there.
Okay, I believe it.
Yeah, so...
At the pep rally, though, when Coach Voigt makes his speech, he does at least 3 Hitler salutes.
Yeah.
And I don't think it was intentional.
It's John Voight, so, like, it's intense.
Yeah.
It's scary.
It's terrifying.
And it's John Voight.
Yeah, and then he becomes the main antagonist in the movie. Yeah. And it escalates so quickly from, like, oh, he just wants to win, he doesn't care about these kids, to, oh, he's making them take performance-enhancing drugs to play injured. Like, it intensely increases in its scope.
And it's just... I mean, he's like a vaudeville villain. Here. Yeah. He at points, he should have a twirling mustache.
Yeah.
Sadly enough, I will say, he's one of the better developed characters in the film.
Yeah, I would agree.
I was saying this to you just the other day after we watched it. Billy Bob is weirdly, probably the weirdly he's the best developed character. He has the strongest character arc.
I don't know if I would personally agree with that. So the Billy Bob plotline, he's a humongous offensive lineman. The first scene of the movie, I believe he's eating pizza for breakfast and drinking maple syrup.
And dipping the pizza in peanut butter.
And he has a pet pig named Bacon.
Yeah.
In the first, or it might not have been the first game, in one of the games where they're playing, the game where Lance gets injured, Billy Bob gets a concussion.
Mm-hmm.
And he tries to keep playing, or maybe it's the next game that Lance gets injured while he's trying to play with a concussion.
The coach is also, like, making him still play.
So his whole thing is dealing with this concussion. But honestly, it wasn't as serious as it could have been, especially because in today's football, concussions are an incredibly serious topic because we're seeing NFL veterans have horrible lives after playing, and some of them develop mental illness and kill themselves. It happens too frequently. It's disturbing in my eyes.
It's the dark spot the sport's been ignoring.
Yeah, and they don't want people to talk about it. Like the Madden NFL video game, they don't let you can't get a concussion in that game. It's just not in the game.
Yeah.
Because the NFL won't let them have their license unless they don't have it.
It's funny how this film like touches the subject matter and could make some kind of like point, but either, I mean, nobody was aware maybe fully, or like we said, the work here wasn't really done that well.
I mean, this is late 90s, so it's still pretty early in that, exploring that part of football. But Billy Bob gets this concussion, and then he keeps playing, and he tries to push himself, and he's, like, too hurt, and the coach yells at him. And then he has a weird suicidal moment.
Yeah, he has, like, this nervous breakdown where he's shooting his trophies. And, like, drinking tequila. His life's terrible.
Yeah.
I mean,
like there's an arc there, but I don't think it was very well done, because then after he's like, okay, I'm fine.
I don't mean strongest as in like strongest ever. I just mean strongest within the confines of the picture. Him and, Vanderbeek's character are definitely the two most developed characters.
Yeah. And I would agree with
they
that.
They do definitely like rely on each other to kind of get to where they need to be.
Yeah.
Cause I mean, the whole plot of the film ends up where if Vanderbeek's character doesn't succeed on winning the big game coming up, that the coach is going to ruin his chances of going to the college he wants to go to just by being a dick.
Yeah, so Vanderbeek had gotten into Brown, and he was very educated and stuff, and his dad hated that.
Yeah.
And he
was, like, done with football after this, so he didn't fucking care.
And he never played or anything because Lance was the star quarterback, and he would never get – Lance was going to go to Florida State.
Yeah.
Which is a football power.
Yeah.
And so he wanted to go to Brown, and Voight was like, Coach Kimball, I believe, right? Bud Kimball?
No, that's Rod Kimball from Hot Rod. This is like Kilborn or Kilmer.
Yeah.
Kilmer.
Kilmer? Yeah. Okay. Coach Kilmer was like, if you don't play in this game and listen to exactly my plays, I'm taking away your scholarship. He's like, you can't do that. And he's like, fuck you.
He's like, watch me.
Yeah. And so he has to listen to him, but the whole team kind of rallies around hating him.
But Vanderbeek, at this point, is like, well, I'm just not going to play. I'm just going to screw it, blah, blah, blah. He's evil. And then he runs into Billy Bob when he finds out, like, no one can find him.
Yeah.
They have a heart-to-heart.
Yeah.
And then they are like, let's do this. Let's play this game. Yeah. The movie ends with them kind of, like, forcing the coach out.
Yeah.
They all take a stand. They're all like, we're not going to follow you. It looks like he's going to go kill himself.
Yeah, he has like a crazed speech where he's like, I'm the coach. Let's go out on the field. Let's go on the field. He says it like, come on. Yeah. Let's go on the field like a dozen times. And there's this weird long 2-minute scene of him in the hallway like walking. And then before the game even ends, he's already packing up his office, which is an amazing thing.
And so the big payoff with the writing here is that the injured player kind of becomes their coach all of a sudden.
Yeah.
He helps them win. Vanderbeek gets to like win the big game by doing his crazy plays, and Billy Bob has a couple of redemption moments. One of them was my favorite moment in the film, which I was like, wait for it, Scott. It's going to happen. Because this movie heavily keeps using the Foo Fighters song, My Hero.
Yep.
And like they used it like 4 times, just like 30 seconds of it. And I was like, why do they keep doing this?
Yeah.
But then...
it was like their intro when they came on the field.
Yeah.
I think there was a montage of them winning games with My Hero.
And so at one point, Billy Bob's like, I got this. I'm going to open whatever was going on. He's going to, like, plow the field, basically, and get where he needs to be.
Yeah.
And he just... They show it. They show him. It's a really pretty shot, actually, of him, like, running across the field.
Yeah.
I noticed how, like, they actually had good cinematography here.
Yeah.
But it's just, like, this really intense close-up of this huge man, like, running the field to Foo Fighters. And it's like, an amazing shot, but it's just... Like I said,
it's
nothing's
so
earned.
Ridiculous.
Nothing's earned in this film. Yeah. Only the humor. It's earned by accident.
Yeah. The humor lies in the horrific Texas accents that everybody's putting on. Literally everybody... is doing whatever they want for an accent.
Yeah.
Every one of them was terrible. Particularly James Vanderbeek's was so bad that it was amazing.
Yeah.
Gosh. The total package here is honestly a really poor film that's redeemed by how accidentally funny it is.
Yeah.
Then you have Hot Rod, which is the much better written film.
Mm-hmm.
The comedy, it didn't hit for me every time, but that's how most comedies are. They're not going to be every single joke is a knee slapper. But when it does hit, it's very good. And it rides that line of stupid. It makes plays on things that you see in movies. Like there was one scene where he's tumbling down a mountain. And whereas in Mac and Me, when they fall into the river, it's like a 2-second shot on falling. And this one, it was like a 2-minute scene of him just tumbling down multiple different hills.
It's preceded by a 2-minute punch dance in the woods scene. So it's just like we said it.
Yeah, like out of Footloose, it felt like.
And it borders stupid, and it's not afraid to jump into stupid anytime.
Yeah. And it's a pretty simple plot. Like, the whole device of his stepdad being sick and him needing her money, like, it's very just tacked on to be a vehicle for the movie for them to do the stupid things
that
they
do. Which is a joke later in the film when Chris Parnell says, that's a very convenient number.
Yeah, like they need $50,000. But overall, the writing's a lot better.
Yeah.
The best for me was every time they'd, like, scene transition with particularly Bill Hader and Danny McBride's characters, they'd be doing something ridiculous. Like, there's one where Danny McBride is just high-fiving Bill Hader and I'm already forgetting his little brother, Jorma, over and over again. And then as soon as Andy Samberg's character walks in, Danny McBride's just like, that's how you do it.
Yeah, and that's how it's done.
And he has the best lines for me.
Yeah, there's
like my
one,
favorite line is...
There's one, I think you couldn't breathe when he said it, but gosh, I'm not even going to say it right. He says... pools are really great at holding water.
Yeah, they're filling a pool.
Yeah.
And he, it's just like, it jumps into the middle of a conversation. Is like, and that's why pools are really great at holding water. And then, but the actual line that I love the best was when he's been like, I've been drinking green tea all day.
Yeah.
He's beating up a guy for no reason.
It's, he's just great in the film.
It's ridiculous. He talks about a dream sequence he has. Where he had a terrible nightmare where he had to fight, like, 100 wizards in a tower and then, like, make love to all their wives.
Yeah, their wizard wives.
Yeah.
No, I mean, there's a lot of little stuff like that, too. Like, dumb jokes that help with the characters being weird.
No.
And aren't too out there. Because there's some jokes that are just out there.
Yeah, the spirit animal thing.
Yeah.
That bit got old for me, like,
the first
after
time they
two.
Used it, it
yeah.
was funny.
Yeah.
Yeah. But then they use it so much.
Yeah.
But then there's jokes like where Kevin, his brother, goes to show him a video on his computer and just pulls up a video of two dogs humping each other.
Yeah.
And it lingers too long on the video, but it's funny because of how dumb it is.
And then the best part of it was his save. He's like, oh, sorry, that's for mom. And then Andy Samberg's character's like, oh, yeah, mom loves that.
Yeah.
And it's just so stupid.
There's this ridiculous scene where, and this is more editing than anything, but they say cool beans to each other.
Oh,
and
yeah.
They just edit it into this like rap. But they actually did that. Andy and Akiva and Jorma edited that little moment. And the first time they previewed it, the producers were like, get rid of that.
Yeah.
And then they were like, come on. And like talked him back into putting it back in.
Yeah.
And I think they tested it and it didn't test well until they added that scene back in.
Yeah.
So it like helped it test better.
Yeah, it's a funny scene.
Yeah,
it's like 15 seconds too. Because I had heard about the cool beans scene before.
Yeah, yeah.
And I thought it was going to be like a full musical number, so I'm glad it wasn't.
Yeah, yeah, they knew where to draw the line on that.
Yeah,
because it's ridiculous.
Yeah,
but...
and the whole movie's ridiculous. And it had its script was originally not written by the Lonely Island guys, but then it got late rewrites by them. They redid the whole script, the three of them. So, and you can tell when you watch the movie that that's what happened, because it's just got their fingerprints all over it.
So writing, we got to give it to.
Yeah, I'm giving it to Hot Rod for sure.
Yeah, for sure. And direction, I'd say Hot Rod as well, because the performances are more sincere.
Yeah, I would agree with that.
Yeah. Like you said, there's no... The only person here who has an accent that doesn't work is Isla Fisher.
Yeah.
She switches between Australian, English, and standard
American.
It was
all over the map, yeah.
Just nonstop.
Yeah.
So...
Yeah, we didn't even talk about, like, Will Arnett's character. Will Arnett plays her douchebag boyfriend, and he has some funny lines. He's barely in the movie, but my favorite was when, what was his friend's name?
Sully!
Yeah.
Sullivan!
Yeah, Sullivan, you chode! Like, they see it, they're at an Applebee's,
yeah,
and he's just, like, the perfect asshole. It reminded me a lot of a movie I don't think you've seen, but there's a movie called Fired Up. It's a parody of... the Bring It On movies.
Yeah, we've talked about
it. And there's a character in it who it's like the exact same as the doctor in that movie. And it's very funny. But now the humor works a lot better. Comedy is so reliant on the writing.
Yeah.
A good comedy is not going to bad writing. And Hot Rod tried to do both physical comedy and just like, I don't know what you call banter comedy. Like
situational.
Yeah, situational.
Yeah.
And I don't think the physical comedy worked all that much. I think the best moments were definitely the banter.
The physical comedy worked best in montage.
Yeah.
There's the birthday party sequence where they're earning money.
Yeah.
Almost every single physical gag in that sequence is hilarious.
Where he just lights himself on fire.
Yeah, he lights the whole birthday party on fire. Yeah. There's a pinata scene. There's where the fridge just hits him.
Yeah, that one, it was ridiculous. There's one where he just gets hit by a van.
Yeah, and it's just... Back to back, it works because you don't need much in a montage. Yeah. You just need the moments.
But if you're setting each of those up, it wouldn't work as well because then you're adding this build up to him randomly getting hit by a fridge.
Yeah.
The humor of it is how random it is.
Yeah.
So it loses it if you build it up like that.
And I mean, this is definitely an experiment for them when you think of it that way.
Yeah.
From moving from short form to long form.
Yeah.
And their short form stuff can be as random as you want.
Yeah, because
it works.
There's not enough of it to you're not fleshing out a whole idea really. You're just hitting that idea.
You're
like
doing the jokes.
Like Dear Sister is an amazing digital short.
Yeah.
It would not work as a 90-minute feature.
God, no.
Though it actually might. Now I'm thinking about it because I love it.
It might.
One thing that's Jorma, was that his name?
Yeah.
He was the writer and director of MacGruber.
Hmm.
I didn't know that.
That's good to
I was
know.
Looking up their stuff. So, like, they've all...
I know a lot of people who love MacGruber.
I know a lot of people love it, and I've never seen it either. But I think it's right around this percentage as well.
Well, we've kind of dipped into acting in this category as well. So we could just quickly sum that up.
Man. Yeah, I mean, I don't think either movie has outstanding acting.
No, it's sounding...
I'm not the biggest fan of Andy Samberg as the main guy. I've tried to watch Brooklyn Nine-Nine, and I just can't really get into it. I know a lot of people who love him, though, so... I'm not, it just might not be for me, but I love the cheesiness and the schlockiness of Varsity Blues acting. Like, Allie Larder was terrible.
Yeah.
But again, that might not actually be good acting. That might be that accidental humor coming in.
I think it leans to accidental.
Yeah.
I personally will have to give acting to Hot Rod just because the ensemble together works.
Yeah, the Bill Hader and Danny McBride in particular, and Will Arnett, like the background characters are so much stronger in Hot Rod.
And they work. Like even Sissy Spacek, she plays it as a mom who's concerned about her family.
Yeah.
She's like, come sit down by your father, it'll make him feel better. And the two characters have been literally fist fighting the entire movie. And it's just funny that like she's sincerely doing it. There's this ridiculous moment at the end where, if you haven't seen Hot Rod, he does save his stepfather. He gets the heart. And then it cuts to a year later. They have a similar sequence to the beginning sequence where he fights his stepfather in the beginning of the movie.
Yeah.
This time it's this huge brawl where they're breaking down walls.
Yeah, it's ridiculous.
He finally kicks his stepfather's ass.
Yeah.
And so very slowly, Ian McShane turns around on the car and he's like, you did it. You're a man now. And then... Andy Samberg's character, Hot Rod, he does this ridiculous move where he makes him shit himself immediately.
Yeah.
That's where the movie ends.
The Tai Chi move.
Yeah. And it's just like, the intensity of Ian McShane delivering that, like, that heartfelt, you're a man, and then, like, just shitting himself immediately.
Yeah.
It's just little things like that where I'm like, the acting definitely, for me, teeters over here because it's comedy, it's difficult, and for them to deliver the laughs, I think that's better than... I don't think a single moment in Varsity Blues was I, like, emotionally compromised or invested.
Like, the ones that I can think of are, like, the I Don't Want Your Life scene.
Yeah.
Like, they're funny. They're not dramatic.
Funny. They're iconic.
Yeah, they are iconic, but not for good reasons.
Exactly. So, I lean Hot Rod.
Yeah, I probably lean Hot Rod, too, in thinking about it. But I just want to give a shout out to how bad everything was in Varsity Blues. It was the perfect storm of bullshit.
I think if you haven't seen Varsity Blues, anybody should watch it. Yeah. It's worth the watch.
Yeah, so. For sure. Our next category is visuals.
Visuals. This is tough.
Yeah, and it's kind of funny to judge movies like these on visuals because, like, Hot Rod or Varsity Blues are not really doing anything particularly innovative.
They're not, but Hot Rod has a surprisingly, like, pretty palette to it.
Yeah, the film style was interesting.
Yeah.
It wasn't bright and colorful by any means.
It was like, borderline retro at points with kind of a northwestern feel to it.
Yeah, I definitely agree.
And there's a lot of beautiful shots.
In Hot Rod?
Yeah, like when they're out in the woods doing the Tai Chi stuff.
Yeah.
There's pretty shots there. When they're on the roads, just like doing stuff on the road. The generic stuff doesn't work as well.
Yeah.
But there are moments like the musical bit.
Yeah.
Where the riot breaks out. It's just like, it's shot very compelling. So it's interesting.
Yeah. One of the things I like about Hot Rod too is all the action stays in frame. They don't really cut away. And I mean, it's not an action movie, but like when he's crashing the bike, you see the bike crash happen.
Yeah.
So it's stuff like that that's satisfying. Whereas another film, a lesser film, might do a cutaway and then you just see him scattering across. Yeah. So.
They definitely show the moments, which is cool.
And it's not an effects heavy film at all.
Yeah.
Which is good because I don't think with their budget they would have done good effects.
I think that explosion and like halfway through when they explode the platform is probably, besides the final stunt, like the biggest stunt they did.
Yeah.
So
it's not, I don't think it's really hitting on a high level in cinematography or anything, but it does what it needs to do.
It's a solid look.
Yeah. But Varsity Blues looks very 90s, not just because it's dated.
Yeah.
You mentioned the football scenes, and some of them are good. They're very stereotypical, like the same action that you see in Remember the Titans, We Are Marshall, The Replacements. I'm trying to think of more. Any Given Sunday.
All
the football movies. It's the same scenes of like them hitting each other in midair. Every time there was a tackle, it was like they both leading with their helmet and colliding in midair.
Slow motion. The field.
There was some funny slow motion of James Vanderbeek taking off his helmet and just jiggling.
There's too much.
Too much jiggle.
But like I said, I was impressed with that one shot where Billy Bob's running. There's a couple good low angle shots I noticed during the game.
Yeah.
The rest of the film just looks whatever.
They did some interesting stuff where like it's showing the action, but some other thing will happen, whether it's a fan or another player comes through the foreground. So it's like you're trying to watch, and I think that's sort of interesting. But neither film, or Varsity Blues certainly doesn't really do anything impressive with its camera work.
No.
There was the scene where James Vanderbeek's father and Lance's father goad them into the throwing competition, and they did this crazy thing where it was like these low angles like shooting up of all these people making fun of James Vanderbeek.
Yeah.
So you can't throw it, like stuff like that, including a very young Jesse Plemons. Mm-hmm. He was just like a bratty kid in this. But it wasn't good. It was just weird.
Yeah. If you could like evenly weigh them, I think Hot Rod takes this one just slightly.
Yeah, I would agree.
Because there's nothing super impressive there. Like we said, there's cool stuff.
Yeah.
But with Varsity Blues, it's just too back and forth.
Yeah, I would say neither film has distractingly poor visuals, but neither film you're going to go like, wow, like this is a real treat.
Varsity Blues would shine visually if you had never seen any football movies ever before.
Yeah, if this was your first football movie, you'd then watch like Remember the Titans and be like, they're just Varsity Bluesing.
Yeah, exactly. music?
I give the edge to Varsity Blues.
Dude, same here. No argument.
There's some funny songs
in Hot Rod.
I can't honestly even think of any off the top of my head.
They have Two of Hearts playing one, but Two of Hearts when they're like dancing.
Oh, yeah.
That's like the one thing that comes to my head. And then the musical where they march through the streets.
Yeah, and there was like a hair metal band, not metal, a classic rock kind of band
like
playing.
Band.
Yeah. And I read that that's a real band. I think the Stone Temple Pilots, was it?
It's either that. No, it's not Stone Temple. It's maybe
Queens of the Stone Age.
Queens of Stone Age.
Yeah.
That's it. Yeah.
They're not playing as Queens of the Stone Age, but
just playing some random.
It's kind of funny that they're probably in the movie for 40 seconds. So
I mean, the music works for the movie.
Yeah.
But there's nothing you really remember besides those three key moments. There's a funny band. There's a weird musical number, and then they're dancing to a dumb song.
Yeah.
However, Varsity Blues has like 90s hits. It has Thunderstruck by AC/DC, and
it
that's
sure
actually.
Does.
visually, that scene was cool because it was matching to the beat.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's probably the best thing they do at certain points of this film is edit to the beat really strongly with iconic music.
Sometimes I really hate that. Like, I remember Dungeons & Dragons did it in a way that really bugged me.
Yeah.
But Dungeons & Dragons was doing it where, like, the characters would move their head to the beat, and that's too much.
Yeah.
Whereas the Varsity Blues, it's like the action happens to be going to the beat, like a Shaun of the Dead kind of
See,
does.
If the D&D movie did it to Thunderstruck by AC/DC,
it might have actually worked.
It'd be more accurate to D&D, and it would be cooler.
I liked the D&D theme, so let's back off that.
Dude, we discussed it. We liked it, but they looped it at some point, and it got bad.
It was the only song in the movie.
Yeah.
Also, Varsity Blues has My Hero.
As My Hero has some Green Day songs.
Yeah, it does have some Green Day.
It just has a good collection of rock.
Yeah, of 90s rock.
Yeah, and I mean, even just like a couple timeless songs in there too, but
yeah,
it works. It's good. It matches the visuals.
Yeah,
it matches the story. It's the kind of music these guys would probably listen to at the time.
Yeah.
So
I hope that the Varsity Blues TV show on country music television doesn't just do country music.
Yeah,
I don't
they need
think
to do
that's
90s
gonna work.
Rock.
Yeah, but I don't know if they will. It's something market.
That's true.
Music will give the edge to Varsity Blues though. So.
Varsity Blues for sure.
And then we have Moxie. This is just kind of like a, you know, what had that boom for you?
For me, it's strange because with Hot Rod, I don't know how I'm going to pick this one here. When I think about Hot Rod, Lonely Island, like I said before, their online presence was so influential for me.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like I watched all their shit. I loved what they did. I was so happy when they made it to SNL.
Yeah.
Seeing them make movies like was my thing. I saw this movie twice when it came out. I thought it was hilarious.
Yeah.
It hasn't aged as well for me. And I was telling you, I feel like a lot of these jokes at the time felt so cutting edge, but now
it's like revolutionary at the time.
Yeah, now it's just like old hat. Like everyone's done it.
Yeah, now there's dozens of YouTube comedians.
The whiskey or whatever.
Yeah.
I know Family Guy.
What are you talking about? Yeah, Family Guy had a big bit about it.
I've seen somebody else do that, and it's just it's old.
Yeah,
but
that's another bit that
went too long. I feel like they did, but I don't really know because I don't watch Family Guy.
And I feel like Family Guy did because I don't watch Lonely Island stuff. And I've seen that on Family Guy.
Yeah, so it's one of those things where some of the jokes have just permeated into society. So.
And that brand of humor just in general has like awkward, random humor has become a type of humor that's very commonplace now.
And it's honestly probably moved with our generation too. So
it certainly has.
Mature and go more into the industry. So do these jokes.
Yeah, for sure.
You can see it in commercials now.
Yeah.
So while, I mean, at the time this felt really cutting edge, it feels dated for me now, and that kind of downgrades the film for me in some sense. So
for me, I didn't see Hot Rod when it came out, and I didn't see Varsity Blues when it came out, so I'm judging them both from a 2017 lens. And something about, I keep going to this so bad it was good, but like Varsity Blues, it doesn't really age well. But it's so rooted in a time period that is that I look upon very fondly that I liked that about it. Like I don't like when a movie doesn't age well.
Yeah.
But it almost holds the 90s up because it's everything 90s.
Yeah. I mean, it's an MTV movie.
That for one is a big. You
it
got
stars,
the Moon Man
it
at the start.
It stars fucking Dawson Creek. Yeah. Dawson S. Creek stars in this movie.
And apparently, if it wasn't James Vanderbeek, it was going to be Josh Jackson, right?
Fuck, they messed up then.
I fucking love Joshua Jackson.
Same.
Yeah.
I mean, he wears giant baggy pants that are two sizes too big, but he wears them at waist height, which is like a sign of the 90s.
Yeah, he's wearing like dad jeans.
Yeah. I mean, it's just there's a guy with a Caesar cut at one point.
Yeah, I remember pointing it out.
It's
it was a
ridiculous.
Terrible Caesar cut.
I mean, this movie is so damn funny. It takes itself serious completely.
Yeah,
which I think adds to everything.
It definitely does because I imagine during like the press junket, the director and James Vanderbeek being like, "I think we really delivered a movie that can make you laugh, but it makes you feel."
Yeah.
When it doesn't make you feel, it just makes you laugh more for the wrong reasons. But it works for it.
It definitely, I mean, it was enjoyable.
Yeah.
We laughed the entire time. We laughed more in this than in Hot Rod.
Which is weird, because I would say Hot Rod's the funnier movie, but we laughed more in Varsity Blues. So I'm giving my Moxie point to Varsity Blues.
I give it to Varsity Blues as well.
Oh. But I think if we tally it up, that's three for Hot Rod and two for Varsity Blues.
So on a good film basis, Hot Rod just kind of barely edges out Varsity Blues.
And this versus, for sure.
On an enjoyable sequence. I think you'll be fine either way.
Yeah, I don't think you're going to enjoy one significantly more than the other. Yeah. But if you're on an airplane and for some reason the two movies that they have available to you are Varsity Blues and Hot Rod, I'm probably putting Varsity Blues on.
Yeah, I think I would too.
Yeah.
Honestly.
Also, there's some nips in Varsity Blues.
There's a lot of boobs.
Not a lot of boobs, right?
They're at a strip club.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I forgot. How did I forget about this? I remember there was one character who, like, barely shows the nips at the start, so you think it's going to be that kind of movie where it's like, ooh, just a little. And then there's, like, a lengthy strip cut.
That's when I was like, guys, we just saw nipple. And you guys were like, no, we didn't. You guys meaning you and my wife. And then you guys were like, rewind it. And so I did. And you were like, holy shit. And then, like, 20 minutes later, they're in a strip club.
Yeah. And I was like, no, this is the kind of movie it is.
I will say, I kind of wish that subplot played out more.
Yeah, that subplot started and just ended for no reason.
There was a subplot where...
there was no payoff.
Their teacher who was teaching them sex ed was a stripper.
Yeah, they were like, how does she get such a nice car?
Yeah, they see her stripping one night, and then she's like, mortified, and then she just keeps doing her stripping stuff. Yeah. More power to her.
And then afterwards, she like drinks with them. And by the way, they're high schoolers.
But they're 18.
Right.
They mentioned it like 6 times in that scene. But, which, that doesn't help the drinking.
No.
But it definitely helps them at least being mature.
Yeah.
But no, it's just a plot line from there. At one point, she's like, now, boys, we're not going to have trouble in class. And they're like, no. But Billy Bob's like, will you go to prom with me?
Yeah.
And like, that's it. That's where
that's
the end
of the plot line.
But it could have been, they could have done something else with it.
There should have been a payoff where like they have to they blackmail her into getting John Voight out or something.
Yeah.
I don't know what you would have done.
Or
just something where that
even
comes up again.
Even the end narrative. It ends with narrative, by the way, where James Vanderbeek's like,
oh yeah, and it was
Billy
so
Bob,
stupid.
He went on and did this because he does that.
Yeah.
And this guy, Tweeter did that because Tweeter does that.
Yeah.
And it could have just been like, and Mrs. So and so. She went to prom with Billy Bob.
Yeah. And then
just
it's like,
simple.
Okay, that delivers.
Yeah.
Maybe when Billy Bob's all depressed, calls up the teacher.
Yeah.
Hey, Billy Bob needs some help. You know. By the way, the end narrative is so stupid. There's no narrative in the entire movie until the very, very end. And it was laughably. I don't even know what it said.
Basically what I just did.
Yeah.
So.
Man. So maybe because of all the boobs, you don't watch Varsity Blues on an airplane.
No, you definitely do. You make everyone uncomfortable.
Oh,
unless
there's
a kid next to you, because that ain't cool.
You heard it here first. You got any more thoughts on these two?
No,
they're both probably in the upper echelon of the movies we've watched for the
podcast. Oh, for sure. I think they were enjoyable watches. I think our grading is pretty accurate.
I'd agree.
Point for point, Hot Rod's just a better made film.
Yeah.
But if you want to just fucking laugh at something dumb and be a little bit nostalgic the whole time, Varsity Blues ain't going to do you wrong.
Yeah, get your blue on.
Yeah, we were really hoping they would name drop that.
Yeah, I love a good name drop. I don't think a Hot Rod was mentioned in the movie, was it?
No.
Yeah, so two swings and a misses on the titular
line. We just
lines.
Needed somebody to be like, I just got a case of the Varsity Blues.
Yeah, that would have made the film. Then it would have won the writing.
Yeah, section. That's true.
Max, where can the good people find us?
Well, you can find us. Find us in Texas, man. Playing football.
Texas forever.
Texas forever. Clear hearts. Something
Stop.
Can't lose. Or you can find us at thecriticalbreakdown.com.
Yeah.
You can find me and Danny McBride filling kiddie pools. Or you can find me on Twitter at Max Rivera Film.
You can find me sneakily reading Kurt Vonnegut books while I'm supposed to be working. Or you can find me at breakdown_Scott. We got an email address, thecriticalbreakdownpodcast@gmail.com. Let us know which you prefer. You've seen them both. What do you think is the versus winner?
Which is better?
Yeah.
As always, rate us and review us on iTunes. We got some good ratings coming in lately.
Yeah,
some good reviews.
Yeah, feels
that
good.
That always helps us on the charts.
It helps on the charts and it helps us in our hearts.
It helps us know that we're doing a good job, guys.
Yeah, the feedback actually, it really is surprisingly helpful. Even if I'm like literally asking people to do the review, it's still nice to know someone reviewed.
For sure. Just, I mean, takes less than 5 minutes.
Yeah.
If you have time, we appreciate it. If not, just keep listening.
Yeah.
You'll get time eventually.
Yeah, and just be on with your day, man. I hope it's a good day.
Hope it's a great day.
Yeah.
Jason Brown did our music.
And Josh Rivera did our art. We're the podcast boys.
Next week on The Critical Breakdown.
Put your signature here, because we're watching Hancock.
Rated 41% on Rotten Tomatoes. Dum dum da da.
wild.